Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. The first portfolio is Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands. To invite members wishing to ask a question to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. I can advise the Chamber that we are extremely tight for time across the whole of the afternoon. There is quite a bit of interest in all three of the portfolio questions, and therefore the usual plea for brevity in questions and answers has added emphasis this afternoon. And I call question number one, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to incorporate the ownership and management of community assets in urban areas into its Land Reform Scotland Bill.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you, President Officer. The Land Reform Bill sets out ambitious proposals that will change how land is owned and managed in our rural and island communities for the better. And I appreciate that one size and indeed one bill most definitely does not fit all. This government recognises the need to continue to develop policies and programmes for land in urban areas that reflect local needs and priorities. That's why in March the Cabinet Secretary announced a review of the community rights to buy to look at how effective our current powers are in both urban and rural areas.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank the Minister for the answer. In 2020, after the heart of New Haven Primary School was closed, a community asset transfer bought the building into public ownership, allowing it to serve its area as a community hub. Local engagement is so important, yet provisions on the community engagement in the Land Reform Bill only apply to holdings that are thousands of hectares. Can the Minister advise how the Scottish Government will ensure good use of land which are smaller than those mentioned in the Bill?
Minister.
Yeah, I absolutely take on board the point that the Member raises. And the Regeneration Investment Programme that is supporting communities to develop and take ownership of land and assets across Scotland, and to date it has included over £265 million invested through the Regeneration Capital Grant Fund, supporting nearly 230 community-led projects and almost £27 million through the Vacant and Derelict Land Investment Programme. With this programme bringing back just over 112 hectares of persistent vacant and derelict land back into use, and we will continue to deliver vacant and derelict land fund with five eligible councils, each currently receiving a share of £7.65 million in 23, 24 and £5 million planned for 24-25.
Supplementary, Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Whilst we want communities to benefit from land ownership, it must be done in a way that's fair and proportionate. So can I ask the Minister how the Scottish Government will determine when the lotting of land is in the public interest and what steps he will take to ensure the bill, the Land Reform Bill, complies with existing property rights?
Minister.
I have to say, it's actually the Cabinet Secretary who's taken the Land Reform Bill through. I'm actually answering on her behalf, so I apologise if I don't give you a full answer on that. My understanding at this stage is that the Government were looking at, I think it was over 1,000 hectares, it might be 3,000. I can't honestly give you the right numbers for that, but it's something that I know the Cabinet Secretary has been looking at, so we can get a fuller answer to you in writing.
Question two, Alexander Burnett.
Thank the Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when the Rural Affairs Secretary last met with the Forestry and Land Scotland, and I note my register of interest regarding forestry and renewable energy.
Minister.
As the Member will be aware, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs regularly consults with officials from Forestry and Land Scotland, and as he is aware, I know he is aware of this, she raised the issues around flooding with Forestry and Land Scotland on his behalf. She regularly meets with them, where the last two meetings focused on finance took place on the 28th of March and the 1st of May of this year.
Alexander Burnett.
New FOI figures show that last year more than 1 million trees on public land were felled to make way for wind farms. And constituents, such as those near Brownhill Forest at Craigdorney, are reporting that forest roads owned by the Scottish Government are being improved to a higher specification than required for simple timber extraction. This is clearly being done in expectation of wind farm developments that have yet to be consented, which makes a mockery of the approval process. So can I ask the Minister if he was aware of such activity, if he approves of such activity, and whether these additional costs to be met by wind farm developers or just another cost being borne by the taxpayer?
Minister.
Yeah, again, I have to reiterate the point that I made to your colleague Rachel Hamilton. This is not my bill, it's not my area. I wasn't aware of the issue that you gave me, but I will get the Minister, the Cabinet Secretary, to write to you with details of that.
Through the Chair, please. A number of supplementaries. They'll need to be brief. First, Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Forestry and Land Scotland is a key institution in Scotland's land management. Can I ask the Minister what role the Government envisages that FLS will play in the next chapter of Scotland's land reform journey as we strive to ensure our land benefits the country as a whole and not a privileged few?
Minister.
Over the last 5 years, Forestry and Land Scotland have worked with community groups who want to be more involved in managing Scotland's national forests and land. The community asset transfer of national forests and land have been integral to the creation of businesses, tourism and recreation opportunities and to establishing affordable housing, woodland crofts and community renewable energy schemes, with 25 transfers completed to date. The asset transfer has also empowered communities to address the challenge of rural housing, create new woodland crofts and affordable housing, and communities have benefited from renewable energy developments on the national forests and land, whether through community benefit payments from large-scale wind farm creation, creating substantial funds for local communities to draw on.
Mark Ruskell.
Under the Land Reform Bill, will large FLS land holdings be required to produce publicly accessible land management plans for consultation, bringing much-needed scrutiny by communities and other stakeholders?
Minister.
My understanding of currently, I'm not quite sure of what the member's actually asking me there, because as far as I'm aware that Forest Land Scotland is already publicly accessible. But if that's not a full enough answer, as I said before, please come back to me and I'll ask the Cabinet Secretary to write to you.
I'm Willie Rennie.
Government ministers have repeatedly said we need to have the right trees in the right place, but there's farmland in my constituency that's recently been bought up for tree plantation, even though it's useful for food production. So is the Minister going to use any more controls to make sure we do get truly the right trees in the right place?
Minister.
As Willie Rennie said, I have consistently said we should have the right tree in the right place, but I should also point out it's farmers who sell the land to plant the trees in the first place. If we're going to bring controls in at a later date, then again, that will be done through the Land Reform Bill, and it's the Cabinet Secretary who's taken that forward.
Question three, Richard Leonard.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether the forestry grant scheme is fit for purpose.
Minister.
The forestry grant scheme has consistently delivered a positive outcome set out in the Scottish Rural Development Programme. 85,000 hectares of new woodlands have been supported since 2015, including 40,000 hectares of native woodland and 8,000 hectares through natural regeneration. The Forestry Grant Scheme also contributes to a broad range of other priorities, including public access to woodlands, rainforest restoration, priority species conservation, as well as rural development. Under the Scottish Rural Development Programme, a formal evaluation of the Forestry Grant Scheme for the period 2015-23 is underway and will report during 2024.
Richard Leonard.
Minister, for that reply. 3 weeks ago, I wrote to the Cabinet Secretary about the revelation that the private global investment company Aberdeen was paid a public grant of £2.5 million from Scottish Forestry in August 2023 for planting trees in the Cairngorms, even though the company increased its shareholdings in coal, in oil and gas corporations in the US by £234 million in the same year. Last week, I received a reply from the Cabinet Secretary in which she told me Scottish Forestry does not restrict funding to companies based on their wider business interests. What is the moral justification for that? Does the Minister think that is right? Why is this government so soft on corporations and so tough on everybody else?
Minister.
I'm not entirely convinced that that's correct, but I will get a much fuller answer to the member, and I'll be happy to meet him and talk about those issues.
And supplementary, Finlay Carson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think today it's not so much the right tree in the right place, but whether we've got the right minister in the right place. In February, the minister said that other sources of funding for tree planting would be increased to make up for the savage £32 million cut to forestry grant scheme. Can I ask the minister, what other sources of funding for new woodland creation does he expect to become available? And specifically, how many additional hectares does he believe that this will deliver in the coming financial year?
Minister.
The honest answer to that question is I don't know. I'm answering questions on behalf of the Cabinet Secretary, and I do not have the answer to that question, but we will write to the member with a suitable answer.
Thank you, quite. Point of order, Rachel Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, I seek your guidance. We are here for rural questions. Other than the scripted ones, we have had not one answer. Could the Cabinet Secretary not have just come to rural questions and then dealt with whatever she had to do following that, because she's been seen on social media at Bute House?
Thank Rachel Hamilton for her point. She will be aware that the content of ministerial responses, and indeed who the government chooses to respond to questions, is a matter for the government. Question number 4, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what Forestry and Land Scotland is doing to deliver economic benefit from the land that it manages, including through supporting mountain bike tourism.
Minister.
Forestry and Land Scotland is the custodian of the nation's forests and the woodlands, and recently marked the 5th anniversary since it was formed by this government. The agency works in our forests, and woodland represents at least 40% of the total forestry activity in Scotland and contributes some 10,347 FTE forestry jobs and £382 million GVA to Scotland's economy. And we also host enough renewable energy infrastructure to produce over 1 billion watts of energy and sufficient to power 600,000 homes. FLS is a key partner in delivering the Scottish Mountain Bike Strategy for 23-24, and our forests and woodlands welcome 11 million visitors annually, of which 8% are mountain bikers across Scotland. In the Scottish Borders, this increases to 33%. The Glentress Master Plan resulted in a £6 million public investment, trails and car parks. Other master plans are either in development or developed for other sites which act as a framework for investment. For example, helping inform the £5 million Seven Stains redevelopment project within the Borderlands Growth Deal. And Forest Land Scotland is also actively working with developing Mountain Bike Scotland, trail associations and event organisers across Scotland to support mountain bike.
Thank you, Craig Hoy.
Clearly, unlike the Minister, I recently met with businesses representing mountain biking groups who use Glentress mountain biking trails, which are owned and operated by Forestry and Land Scotland. Following last year's UCI cycling champs, they are concerned that the positive outcomes promised from the event have so far failed to materialise, or have not fully materialised, with trails at Glentress partially closed and the master plan apparently having stalled. So if he's still in his post at the end of the day, will the Minister therefore join me in urging Forestry and Land Scotland to work with local stakeholders, including Scottish Borders Council and local businesses and community groups who form Community Trail Advocacy Tweed Valley, to ensure they secure a positive economic, social and tourism benefit from last year's championship?
Minister.
Yeah, I see that the Member's clearly looking for this collegiate approach that we're trying to get right across the Chamber, but obviously not working. Forestry Land Scotland works with a number of partners and in the use of volunteers for the management across the mountain bike trails, and I will always be very happy to meet with stakeholders in order to see how we can advance things.
Supplementary, Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Forest and Land Scotland should also be looking at providing health benefits as well as economic benefits. The Minister knows that many people like to walk in the forests and cycle in the forests, but Forest and Land Scotland have imposed parking charges, which is putting a lot of people off. Will he look at a review of this policy to make sure everyone has equal access to our forests?
Minister.
The straight answer to that is yes. I'll have a look at that and come back to the member.
Question number 5, Graeme Simpson.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what steps it is taking to protect the welfare of wild bees.
Minister.
The Scottish Government is committed to halting and reversing the declines in wild bee populations, and the pollinator strategy for Scotland sets out the actions we are taking to address the pressures experienced by wild bees, including creating and restoring habitats for these species. We provide updates on these actions in the strategy's annual progress reports. Through the Nature Restoration Fund, we are supporting projects which restore and enhance habitats for our pollinators. This includes providing over £200,000 in the Pentland to Portobello Greening Project, and £140,000 in the Tweed Project, and £89,000 in the Irvine to Girvan Nectar Network.
Graeme Simpson.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? I'm sure he'll agree with me that species-rich grasslands are some of our most biodiverse habitats. They provide a lifeline for wild bees, and they also offer multiple other benefits, including storing vast amounts of carbon. And yet we've seen catastrophic losses of these habitats. If the Scottish Government values Scotland's grasslands in the same way they do peat and woodlands, would they be willing to develop a National Grasslands Action Plan?
Minister.
I absolutely take on board the point the member makes about species-rich grass. I actually used to plant species-rich grass for exactly those reasons. And as the new Agricultural Reform Bill, which is currently going through Finlay Carson and Rachel Hamilton's hands at this moment in time, I'm sure that there are areas within the Agricultural Reform Bill which will allow for the kind of environmentally friendly issues that will help pollinators in that. But I'm quite happy to discuss that with the member as well.
Supplementary, Alistair Allen.
Can I ask the Minister what steps the Scottish Government is taking to deal with the threat posed to Scotland's bees by the parasitic varroa mite?
Minister.
In 2022, we updated our honeybee health strategy, which aims to address the challenges facing honeybees and beekeepers. The strategy is supported by an implementation plan which details a number of actions specifically aimed at minimising the spread of varroa under the auspices of the dedicated varroa working group, including activities to help protect precious few remaining varroa-free areas that we have here in Scotland. We're also providing funding for the apiculture specialists at Scotland's Rural College, who provides education and a support service for beekeepers focused on disease prevention, good biosecurity and treatment for varroa mites.
Briefly, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I need to declare an interest here as a beekeeper and also mention that I'm the new species champion for the moss carder bee, one of Scotland's rarest bee species. Minister, too often conservation funding can be very time limited, so can I ask the Minister what long-term support is available for conservation programmes to secure the future of rare pollinator species like the moss carder bee?
Minister.
Clearly I can't give any commitments today, Presiding Officer, but as I've said, the Agricultural Reform Bill is going through the committee stage at this moment, and the Scottish Government are clearly looking to protect pollinators and all the pollinator strategy that we currently have.
Question 6 has been withdrawn. Question 7, Fergus Ewing.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding undertaking an immediate review of the Water Environment Controlled Activities Scotland Regulations 2011 in order to allow proactive watercourse management to assist farmers, crofters and land managers to protect agricultural land from flooding risks themselves.
Minister.
I continue to work with my Cabinet colleagues to ensure that Scotland has a sustainable water resource for food production, energy and drinking water. And I recently convened a water resource planning roundtable which highlighted the need to manage both water excess and scarcity in the face of a changing climate. While watercourse management can play a role, it's not always effective in reducing water levels and can impact downstream populations. We are bringing in the environmental regulation, including the Water Environment Controlled Activities Scotland Regulations 2011, into an integrated authorisation framework, facilitating a clear process for applications.
Fergus Ewing.
That sounded a bit like a no. Let me quote from one farmer who told me this. Farmers, landowners must be allowed to clear riverbanks and, in some cases, dredge rivers. SEPA stop them at every turn. I've spoken to three farmers who identify overly complex prescriptive system, rarely allowed to remove silt, only use bank protection such as gabion baskets for insufficient lengths to avoid resultant flooding, damaging to public roads, for example the B740, and in some cases farmers actually threatened by SEPA with withdrawal of their single farm payments for infraction, so that many farmers are afraid
question,
to have
Mr.
SEPA
Ewing.
On their farm. Isn't this system a complete failure?
Minister.
No, I don't believe the system is a complete failure. And if what I can tell the member is there is a complete dichotomy between what farmers are asking SEPA to do and what SEPA believes should be done. But SEPA does not ban dredging. Land managers can undertake certain works without the need for SEPA authorisation, including clearing subsurface field drains and man-made ditches. Litter debris and in-stream vegetation can also be removed without SEPA authorisation. Regulatory controls are proportionate to the risk, and sediment removal in agricultural ditches and straightened rivers can be carried out under the authorisation subject to good practice. But there is absolutely no doubt that we are getting far heavier rainfall. We're getting far more surface water coming down. We've got to find a way of holding that water back. And actually, I had the conversation last week with Martin Kennedy from the NFUS. The idea is that clear the rivers, get the water down quicker. But if it gets the water down quicker, it floods somebody else further down. We need to have a much more integrated approach on how we're going to manage our water longer term.
I think it would be supplementary, Tim Eagle.
This is just mentioned, just simply aren't enough. The Minister may be aware that in Moray, the communities of Garmouth and Kingston have suffered terrible flooding, damage to agricultural fields as well as homes and businesses. Many locals can remember parents and grandparents entering the river to clear shingle banks, helping to control the waters of the Spey in years gone by. Will the Minister consider changing the regulations to make sure that local knowledge can be used in the future?
Minister.
I won't give that commitment right now, Presiding Officer. What I can say to the member, and I'm not saying this to dampen down the debate, there is an issue with water. We have got a far bigger problem with water now between flooding and drought, and we're getting them in much bigger extremes than we have ever done in the past. We don't hold water in the hills with snow, and we've got an upland area that could catch a lot more water. If we can hold it up there earlier, then it means that we're not going to get the flooding downstream.
Briefly, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will be aware of the repeated flooding that residents in Angus have faced over the last 9 months or so. What reassurances can he give them that effective watercourse and river basement management will protect them from flooding in the coming months?
Minister.
The Government is very alive to the fact that these flooding events have taken place, and the Scottish Government put money into the Brecon area in particular. But the Government is consistently looking at, it's why we held the round table last week or the week before, to look at what we're going to do about water management.
Question 8, Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what cross-government action it is taking to support Scotland's islands and their economies.
Minister.
The Scotland's first National Islands Plan was published in 2019 to coordinate cross-government actions aimed at improving outcomes for island communities. Today, the delivery of the plan has been supported by over £12 million of critical infrastructure. This is additional to our investments in regional growth deals and our Carbon Neutral Islands project, which further benefit the islands. The Islands Cost Crisis Emergency Fund, which has already distributed £2.4 million to help island households and businesses, will be worth £5 million in 2024 and 2025. We will publish a second National Islands Plan next year in collaboration with island communities and local authorities.
Neil Bibby.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Over the last month, the Ardrossan to Brodick ferry route saw 57 cancellations and 3 days where no ferries sailed at all. The current condition of Ardrossan Harbour has led CalMac to claim that it can no longer berth overnight due to the risk of damage to vessels, meaning it can no longer operate the first sailing of the day. That is having a significant impact on the local economy, deliveries and workers. CalMac and Peel Ports are pointing fingers at each other. Meanwhile, the multi-million pound upgrade approved 6 years ago has been paused. Can I therefore ask the Minister, will the Scottish Government use its influence to get all parties around the table to ensure that people travelling from Ardrossan to Brodick have a reliable ferry service?
Minister.
Absolutely. I fully take on board the point that the member is making, and I know that the Cabinet Secretary is very, very keen to make sure we get people around the table to find a solution, to make sure that this island community, this brilliant island community, has got so much resource going for it, gets a solution to get them back on course.
Supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to say that there's an Ardrossan Harbour Task Force meeting next week. Minister, Arran's business community faces additional challenges this summer due to reduced ferry capacity and heightened disruption from Peel Port's closure of Ardrossan's Irish berth. However, despite the negative media caricatures of the island, Arran does remain open for business. How can the Scottish Government and CalMac promote that message, and what practical assistance is being offered to minimise the impact of disruption on the viability and sustainability of Arran businesses?
Minister.
I absolutely take on board the point that Kenneth Simpson makes, and he makes on a regular basis for his constituents. Kenneth Gibson. The Scottish Government consistently are looking to make sure that people understand that all our island communities are open and they're a brilliant place to go for a destination.
Briefly, Jamie Hargrove-Johnson.
On the 13th of March, I asked the Minister in this chamber whether a derogation to the North Sea Cod Avoidance Plan to allow fishing for squid in size 12 nautical miles would be considered. This is absolutely important for the Shetland fishing industry and their local economy. The Minister said it was a matter for the Cabinet Secretary. It's now, and he would ask her to respond to me directly. It's nearly 2 months now, and I've still not received a reply from the Cabinet Secretary. So could I ask the Minister whether one is being considered, one's been rejected, or whether it has been accepted?
Minister.
I will chase that up with the Cabinet Secretary and get back to the member.
And very briefly, Beatrice Wishart.
What engagement has the Scottish Government had with the UK Government about developing short subsea tunnels between some of Shetland's islands? And if the Minister is unable to answer, may I request a response in writing?
Minister.
You will definitely get a response in writing. What I can tell you is that I've met with the Shetland Isles community to talk about the subsidies that you raised with me in the previous session, and I'm very happy to give you a response in writing.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions on rural affairs and islands. There'll be a brief pause to allow front benches to change before we move to the next portfolio. Okay, the next portfolio is NHS Recovery, Health and Social Care. I'd remind members that questions 2 and 7 are grouped together, and therefore I'll take any supplementaries on those questions after both have been answered. Anybody wishing to ask a supplementary question should press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. Again, there is a lot of interest in supplementaries, so therefore the questions and indeed the responses will need to be brief. And I call question number 1, Jackie Bailey.
To ask the Scottish Government what value it places on specialist alcohol services, such as the Primary Care Alcohol Nurse Outreach Service in Glasgow, in dealing with the reported public health crisis in relation to alcohol.
Mr. Jenny Minto.
Thank you. The Scottish Government values all initiatives and actions taken to help address the public health crisis in relation to alcohol. Specialist services play a key part in helping address this emergency, and initiatives such as the Primary Care Outreach Nurse Service help deliver coordinated and person-centred assessment, advice and care for people impacted by alcohol.
Jackie Bailey.
Thank the Minister for that response. But of course, last week, the Glasgow Alcohol and Drug Partnership decided to downgrade the Alcohol Nurse Outreach Service by transferring it to a more generic drugs and alcohol service. This was as a result of SNP cuts to their primary care budget. Does the Minister accept the need to ensure parity of response for alcohol and drug addictions? And will she ensure that the most vulnerable people with alcohol addiction in areas of the greatest deprivation in Glasgow are not let down by this decision?
Minister.
I thank Jackie Bailey for her question, and as she pointed out, this was a pilot set up by the HSPC and also one that was decided to be amalgamated into the Alcohol and Drugs Recovery Service. This is bolstering an existing very successful service with nurses, and is already a service which accesses people that have a drug issue, but also those that have an alcohol issue. So the information that I have received is that this is a good service and will absolutely support those in need of that holistic care.
And brief supplementary, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister provide any update on what action the Scottish Government has taken to reduce health inequalities when it comes to alcohol-related harm, please?
Minister.
The Scottish Government is determined to do all it can to reduce alcohol-related harm. We continue to implement actions outlined in our alcohol framework, which have a strong focus on reducing health inequalities and protecting children and young people, and building on existing measures to change Scotland's relationship with alcohol. These include our world-leading minimum unit pricing policy, which, as evidence suggests, has contributed to reducing health inequalities, with the largest estimated reductions in deaths wholly attributable to alcohol consumption seen in men and those living in the 40% most deprived areas. Alongside MUP, we continue to invest in treatment and a wide range of other measures, including funding for alcohol and drug partnerships, which rose to a record £112 million in 2023-24.
Question 2, Sue Webber.
Ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to support NHS Lothian in reducing CAMHS waiting lists across the region.
Minister Marie Todd.
We continually monitor CAM's waiting times performance and engage with all health boards, including NHS Lothian, and direct tailored support to those with the longest waits, providing access to professional advice. We commissioned health boards to submit performance trajectories up to March 25, which will be updated annually and used to continue targeted improvement work, ensuring all boards consistently meet the CAM standard. Boards were allocated £55.5 million in 23-24 via the Mental Health Outcomes Framework to improve the quality and delivery of mental health services for all, in addition to the core funding that health boards receive.
Sue Webber.
Thank you. Minister, one of my constituents is only 8 years old and has been on the neurodevelopment waiting list for an ADHD assessment for 96 weeks already. The frustration and distress the family are experiencing because of this wait is unacceptable. Despite the school being supportive and offering my constituent one-to-one adult support, he continues to have outbursts that the family are finding difficult to manage. I have already raised this case with yourself, Minister, and you advised me to contact NHS Lothian. I had already done this prior to contacting yourself, as had the family. That's hardly a tailored response. The family have been waiting almost 2 years for just an assessment. They have contacted me as a last resort. Minister, what action should the family take next in the face of these unacceptable waiting times?
Minister.
So we're working very closely with NHS health boards and local authorities to improve services and support for children and young people and their families. And we'll continue to ensure that long waits are appropriately addressed. We're supporting boards to implement the National Neurodevelopmental Specification. And as part of that, we've provided over £1 million to fund 5 pilots, which are focusing on implementing various aspects of the specification, including implementing that getting it right for every child and multi-agency working. We intend to revisit the neurodevelopmental specification to ensure that it continues to be relevant and meets the needs of children and their families. This will involve reviewing learning from those implementing the neurodevelopmental specification to date and understanding how we can better measure this going forward. And we will support health boards and local authorities to work together in line with that specification to ensure that the support is there for the children who need it, regardless of whether they have a diagnosis or not.
Question 7, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, President Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what measures it's putting in place to reduce waiting times for access to CAMs.
Minister Marie Todd.
In my previous answer to Sue Webber, I set out how we monitor CAMS performance and regularly engage with all health boards. In addition to this, the CAM service specification was published in February 2020. That sets out the level of services that children, young people and families can expect from CAMS across Scotland. It's really positive to see the significant and sustained improvements in CAMS waiting times over the last year, most notably national performance against the 18-week CAM standard is the fourth highest since records began and the highest achieved since the quarter ending March 2016.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Minister for that answer, but so far the Government has still failed to meet that target of 90% of children and young people being seen by CAMS in 18 weeks and 1 in 4 are turned away. This not only impacts accessing support for their mental health, excuse me, Presiding Officer, but evidence to the Education Committee suggests it also has an impact on pupils having their needs met in schools. So can I ask the Minister, does she agree with me that delays to healthcare impacting education are unacceptable? And can she set out what conversations she's had with the Cabinet Secretary for Education on improving joined up working?
Minister.
So the Member will be aware that we operate the policy of getting it right for every child in Scotland. So it isn't necessary to have a diagnosis in place. It isn't necessary for any support in schools to wait for a diagnosis from health. A delay in accessing healthcare should not delay access to the support required to fulfil a child's right to education. That's really important for people to understand. You mentioned the rejected referrals, and of course, one of the things things is the language is difficult for me to accept. I think it's really important that we consider that many of these referrals are inappropriate and people are redirected to more appropriate support for them rather than an outright rejection. It is not a denial of the difficult situation that children is in. It is simply a more appropriate signposting towards support than CAM service, which of course is a very specialist mental health service.
Okay, I've got a couple of supplementaries. They will need to be brief, as will the responses. First, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wonder if the Minister can provide any further update regarding its latest assessment of CAM's waiting lists and how these compare with last year.
Minister.
So, as I've said a number of times in this chamber, we are seeing positive signs of improvement right across the waiting list compared to previous year. The statistics that were published on the 5th of March 24 show that overall CAM's waiting list decreased by 27% from the previous year. Children waiting over 18 weeks decreased by 53% from the previous year, and children waiting over 52 weeks decreased by 74% from the previous year. We remain committed to supporting all boards to meet the standard that 90% of patients start treatment within 18 weeks of referral.
Paul Sweeney.
Deputy Presiding Officer, NHS Scotland waiting times stipulate that children and young people should only be removed from the CAMS waiting list once they've attended an initial appointment and, where appropriate, when treatment has commenced. However, some health boards are removing people from the CAMS waiting list simply upon an appointment date being received. So what is the government doing to ensure that health boards are only removing people from the CAMS waiting list once they've started treatment?
Minister.
So the issue of the accuracy of data in the mental health system is absolutely crucial to understanding the situation that we face countrywide and the means with which to tackle the challenges that we face. I'd be more than happy to meet with the member and discuss this in more detail, what exactly is happening, not just with the CAMS waiting list, but with other waiting list targets, to ensure that we are working on accurate data and making sure that we are making accurate progress.
Question three, Tim Eagle.
To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to improve ambulance turnaround times.
Minister Jenny Minto.
The Scottish Ambulance Service continually engage with health boards while optimising services, including flow navigation centres and the integrated clinical hub, which provide care for patients at or near home, reducing pressures on A&E departments. The call before you convey protocol is being utilised and cohorting areas have been established at challenging sites, ensuring ambulance crews are freed up during high demand periods.
Tim Eagle.
It is a matter of life and death that ambulances are ready and able to swiftly respond to emergency calls. It is very alarming, then, that we regularly hear reports of ambulances stuck outside A&E departments. Average turnaround times are regularly exceeding 45 minutes, and we have reports from A&E staff, consultants and GPs that sick patients who need a hospital transfer are waiting hours and hours for an ambulance. Does the Minister recognise this is under the SNP's watch that this is happening and that it is placing huge strain on our key NHS workers, and will she make sure with all of her energy that hospitals have the bed space and resources available to ensure quick turnaround times for our ambulances?
Yeah. Minister.
I thank Tim Eagle for his question and recognise that we have to ensure that ambulance turnarounds are as quick and as safe as possible. We have got lots of examples of where work is being done in this, and the government constantly have regular meetings with the health boards to discuss what they're doing and where there might be some blockages. For example, in NHS Grampian, they've established an overspill area which has been robustly staffed over the last month and with 6 overspill beds, and that's available over a 24/7 period.
And brief supplementary, Carol Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Figures obtained by Scottish Labour in my own region show the longest turnaround times for an ambulance at Ayr Hospital and Dumfries and Galloway Royal Infirmary were over 24 hours. In addition, waits of well over an hour have been recorded for critical purple code call-outs. Can the Minister see that whilst our paramedics and NHS staff are working hard and under pressure, this government's mismanagement of the NHS is failing patients and staff? Can the Minister explain, more than meetings, what work they will do collaboratively across the services to address
the pressures on ambulance services?
Patient safety remains, as I said, our top priority, and I apologise to anyone who has experienced any waits for an ambulance team to reach them. The Scottish Ambulance Service is currently reviewing 24-25 recruitment plans to reflect the expansion of innovative services such as flow navigation centres and the integrated clinical hub, which aim to provide as much care as possible for patients and at home or close to home without conveying them to hospital. So that's one action we're doing. It is important to understand where the pressures are and find the right solutions to them, and that's what this Scottish Government is committed to do.
Question 4, James Dornan.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the work that is underway to support people to have more choice and involvement in how their social care is delivered.
Minister Marie Todd.
It's vital that people have informed choice and control about how their social care is delivered through self-directed support. And that's why, as part of the SDS Improvement Plan, we relaunched the Support in the Right Direction programme in April. Over 3 years, 9.9 million will provide independent support, advice and advocacy to help people to access the care that they want. In April, we reopened the Independent Living Fund to new applicants. An initial £9 million investment will help up to 1,000 additional disabled people with complex needs arrange the care that they need to live more independently.
James Dornan.
I thank the Minister for that answer, and I welcome the additional £9 million investment for support in the right direction. But could the Minister maybe expand on Support in the Right Direction's programme and how that enables organisations to deliver independent support and advocacy to help people live independently and participate in all aspects of life?
Minister.
So the Support in the Right Direction funding programme was launched by the Scottish Government in 2018 with the aim of increasing the delivery of independent support for people who need social care. In 2023, we agreed to fund this multi-year programme from 24 to 27 of £3.3 million per year. And the programme is delivered through partnership agreements with third sector organisations and local authority areas across Scotland. Currently, 33 organisations across all 32 local authority areas in Scotland are funded by Scottish Government, and these organisations provide advocacy, brokerage, information and social care planning services to those people who need it.
Question 5, Eleanor Whittam.
To ask the Scottish Government what support it is providing to NHS Ayrshire and Arran to improve access to ADHD testing for adults.
Mr. Marie Todd.
The Scottish Government recognises that more needs to be done to support neurodivergent adults, including those with ADHD, although it is the responsibility of local areas to provide supports and services. We are taking a range of supportive actions. We're providing £650,000 for adult neurodevelopmental pathway pilots in 22-23. We are following those pilots, funding and working with the National Autism Implementation Team to take forward the recommendations of their 2023 report. Support from NAIT, direct to HSCPs, to develop action plans and introduce adult neurodevelopmental pathways and provide professional learning workshops. We're funding a new neuroaffirming community of practice launching in October 23 with positive engagement across health boards. We're publishing guidance on shared care and prescribing ADHD medication to adults following private sector diagnosis. And we're providing £1 million annually for the Adult Autism Support Fund, which offers support not diagnosis dependent to people who have autism. Many of
Eleanor Whittam. Eleanor Whittam.
I thank the Minister for that answer. As the constituency MSP for Carrick, Cumnock and Doon Valley, I've received many, many requests from adults looking for support in accessing ADHD testing, as they recognise the difficulties that they've been facing throughout their entire adult life are symptoms of ADHD. Many have faced multiple challenges, including difficulty maintaining employment, relationships, periods of incarceration and self-medicating. With advice that NHS Ayrshire and Arran have insufficient capacity within existing services to assess and treat in a timeous manner, I really would be grateful for the Minister's advice on what the Scottish Government can do to assist the Health Board and other health boards share information in this regard.
Minister.
So I've made inquiries with Ayrshire and Arran about the actions that they're taking to address waiting times, and we've offered support from the National Autism Implementation Team. I understand that the Chief Officers received a report in February and are currently considering their next steps. Nationally, we were continue to look at how best to develop and support single neurodevelopmental pathways for adults, working with NAIT and local health and social care partnerships and NHS boards. Additionally, NAIT facility, a neurodevelopmental pathway network for professionals, which I am aware that Ayrshire and Arran are part of. We are absolutely committed to working together to improve the position for individuals and their families and to make sure that people can access support when they need it.
Question six, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how the NHS supports the health of rural and islands communities through regular visits from consultants.
Mr. Jenny Minto.
The Government recognises the importance of ensuring equitable access to healthcare for patients in rural and island communities. Individual boards and integration authorities are responsible for planning and delivering services to meet the needs of their communities, and this includes understanding the needs of their populations and designing services which can deliver high quality care. This requires a variety of approaches, including local delivery where possible and where more appropriate, supporting patients to access specialist facilities.
Pastor Allen.
I thank the Minister for her reply. My constituents in Uist are concerned that recent flight timetabling is understood to have prevented some visits by consultants from Raigmore Hospital in Inverness. Can the Cabinet Secretary, can the Minister indicate what can be done to ensure that the timetabling of transport links should be harmonised, giving due consideration to the needs of island communities, to ensure that the level of health care to which islanders should be entitled is not detrimentally affected?
Minister.
Thank Alistair Allen for his question, and as an inhabitant of an island, I recognise the pressures that he talks about. The Scottish Government recognises that more can be done to bring transport planning and health service planning together. However, timetabling of commercial flights are a matter for the airlines involved. In 2023, we prepared the draft transport to health plan and have been working with regional transport partnerships and other partners to deliver the commitments. HiTrans recently convened a meeting of health boards in its area to discuss the establishment of a health and transport action plan, and this is exactly the type of issue that the action plan should be considering.
Very brief supplementaries. First, Douglas Ross.
The question mentions rural health care, which allows me to ask about the campaign to reopen the Birkhead and Hopeman surgeries. The Minister sat through a debate which I held on the 21st of March, and the Government gave commitments that the Evan Borthwick review would be published imminently. It still has not been. And Jenny Minto also promised to meet with Save Our Surgery campaigners. They have still not been offered a meeting, and indeed today said they are being kept in the dark. When can we see the Evan Borthwick review, and when will she meet with Save Our Surgery campaigners?
Minister.
Thank Douglas Ross for his question, and it was a pleasure to meet his constituents who have been campaigning hard for the re-establishment of their GP surgery. I will check to find out when the Evan Borthwick plan report will be published, and I will also chase up my diary if I remain in this role, and hopefully get the meeting as soon as possible, as I have connections to Murray.
Okay, and briefly, Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would urge the Minister to have that meeting as soon as possible because it's urgent. But could I also ask her to have a meeting with Western Isles Council and indeed the Health Board? Because due to budget cuts, the Council have changed their air service provider, their subsidised air service provider, so that the aircraft that is now being used from Uist to Stornoway to access consultants is not accessible to anyone with mobility issues. So our disabled people, our elderly people aren't able to see a consultant in Stornoway. So can I urge her to take
Minister,
that action?
Minister.
Rhoda Grant for her question, and I'm concerned at what she has reported with regard to access to elderly and less mobile constituents of hers. So I'd be very happy to chase that up and respond in writing.
Question 8, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to ensure good dental care provision for elderly residents in care settings.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Building on the recommendations of the Oral Health Improvement Plan in 2018, a bespoke training and mentoring programme was introduced in 2019 to establish a new programme of enhanced domiciliary dental care supported by regulation changes. Under these arrangements, independent dentists are provided specific training which allows them to be accredited to provide dental care to people living in care homes. The overall aim of the programme is to ensure that the appropriate service providers, that the appropriate service provides the appropriate care in the appropriate setting, too many appropriates there, allowing the public dental service to concentrate on more complex domiciliary care and treatment.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Minister for that response. Under new changes introduced late last year, elderly care residents are seeing the frequency of dental checkups halved, and dentists who see multiple patients on a single visit are being financially punished for their efficiency. Dental practitioners have contacted Scotland's Chief Dental Officer, outlining these concerns and proposing a fair solution. Will this government embrace that fair solution, Minister?
Minister.
Alexander Stewart for his question. And after receiving feedback, we recently consulted with the sector on this issue. As a result, last month we introduced an amendment to the Statement of Dental Remuneration, which allows enhanced skill practitioners to claim the regular domiciliary fee in addition to the item of service treatment and the enhanced skills care and treatment allowance. This means enhanced skill practitioners are now able to claim an additional £89.50 for every care home visit. I think this is an example of showing where the Scottish Government is listening to dentists.
Supplementary, Willie Rennie.
The British Dental Association said this week about recruitment of NHS dentists, we just can't recruit. We have enough dentists, but we don't have enough that want to work in the NHS. Is the Minister recognising that a new fee system just isn't working, and what is she going to do about it?
Minister.
I disagree with the premise of Willie Rennie's question. The new fee system was only introduced in November, and we are still working through how that comes. As the member will know, we have a round table tomorrow in this Parliament, if all things remain equal, to discuss dental services. And I think it's important to recognise that the Scottish Government is also considering a range of workforce initiatives, including looking at how we can better utilise dental therapists to provide NHS care. And I've also met with my counterparts in other UK nations, because this isn't just a Scotland issue, to discuss how we can improve the pipeline for overseas dentists to work in the UK. And I'm pleased that the Westminster Parliament is looking at this.
Very briefly, Sandesh Gulhani.
Across Glasgow, there are 140 care homes. For many residents, domiciliary dental care is vital. I visited Woodside Dental Practice, where 96% of patients are NHS. They also operate care at home with over 1,000 residential patients. They have advanced training, and they're saying the SNP is not listening to dentists. It finds that under Determination 1, the financials simply don't work. Payments have been cut by a third, and they will be forced to end the care at home service before the end of May. Will the Minister commit to tackling this latest crisis in NHS dentistry?
Minister.
Or will the SNP let this vulnerable...
I thank Sandesh Gulhani for his question. And as I responded to his fellow Conservative MSP, Alexander Stewart, we have listened to feedback and we have consulted with the sector and we have changed the fee for that dental remuneration.
Briefly, James Dornan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the CAPSEC provide, can the Minister please provide an update regarding what assessment the Scottish Government has made as to the number of NHS dentists there are in Scotland and how this compares to elsewhere in the UK?
And briefly, Minister.
NHS Education for Scotland provides regular data on NHS dental workforce headcount. The long-term trend is positive, with the number of high street NHS dentists increasing by almost a quarter from the period September 2007 to September 2023. We have maintained a strong track record in growing the NHS dental workforce in Scotland, with 57 dentists per 100,000 of the population compared to 42 in England and 46 in Wales.
Okay, that concludes portfolio questions on NHS recovery. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.
Thank you. The next portfolio this afternoon is social justice. Again, should a member wish to seek to ask a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function if online. And at question number one, I call Liz Smith.
You ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the Rural Affordable Homes for Key Workers Fund.
Minister Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I recognise the importance of good quality affordable homes to attracting and retaining people for the benefit of our rural and island communities, including for key workers. I know that a number of local authorities are actively looking to bring forward proposals under this demand-led fund, and affordable homes have already been approved in Orkney. I have written to all local authority chief executives to encourage collaborative working between authorities and relevant partners. I am engaging with local authorities and others, including business interests, to maximise uptake of the fund.
Elizabeth.
Well, thank you. I suppose four homes in Orkney is better than zero homes, which is what my colleague Miles Briggs was told 6 months ago when he asked the same question about the £25 million fund. But does the Minister accept that this situation is entirely unacceptable given the pressure that is facing the rural sector when it comes to attracting the workers that they need? And that was something that John Swinney highlighted in his Courier newspaper interview just this morning. So can I ask, in light of the collapse of the Bute House Agreement, if the needs of our rural communities will finally become a priority?
Minister.
Yeah, thank you, Presiding Officer. Yeah, and they are a priority. I've visited a number of local authorities, including Orkney, as I mentioned before, Shetland, Western Isles, and so on, to talk around about that. It is demand-led, as I said. We have written and contacted chief executives to look at that. And I think it's important that it's the local authorities that take forward to give that strategic overview, and I think that's really important. We've also, Mr Lockhead and I also met with key stakeholders in Perth just before Christmas time, and I've got a follow-up in terms of that. But I said it is demand-led, and I'm happy to meet Liz Smith to discuss that further. But we have made a number of interventions with local authorities to ask them to make sure that they're working strategically with key partners to deliver, as I said, this demand-led service.
Question number two, Willie Rennie, who is online.
To ask the Scottish Government what impact the ending of the Bute House Agreement will have on the Housing Scotland Bill.
Minister Paul McLennan.
The Housing Scotland Bill was introduced to Parliament on the 26th of March 2024. If passed by Parliament, the bill will enable delivery of our commitments for longer-term private sector rental controls, tenants' rights and other protections, duties aimed at the prevention of homelessness and supporting social rented sector tenants experiencing domestic abuse. I will continue to engage with stakeholders. Of course, Parliament will determine the timetable for the bill to proceed, and again, we will work constructively with all members to support the passage of the bill.
Willie Rennie.
So I read that as having no effect whatsoever. I've repeatedly said that if we are to take the insignificant step of introducing rent controls, we need evidence of the impact of the current and previous arrangements. There is a real danger that rent controls create a rent floor rather than a rent ceiling. So is the Minister absolutely confident he has sufficient evidence before proceeding with this bill?
Minister.
Yeah, I am confident. Again, in part of the bill process, we'll be obviously taking evidence. The bill will go through, obviously, through the committee stage, where there'll be a call for evidence, which will obviously include, I would think, responses from stakeholders in that regard. So yes, I think we're confident about what we have just now. Part of the process, as I said, is to continue to engage with stakeholders, but also, as I said, go through the bill process where we are calling for evidence.
Supplementary, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. There's a lot to welcome in the bill, and we have welcomed many parts of it, but rent controls are sitting in this bill, hugely damaging the market in Scotland. We've seen rental controls have led to a decrease in supply. 17% of landlords are saying they will sell or consider selling. Rent controls are driving up rents. We now see the highest rents anywhere, increasing rents anywhere in the UK. So can I ask the Minister a very simple question? Now that the Bute House Agreement has come to an end, will he agree to review the housing bill and work with parties who want to make sure that bill is going to help renters in Scotland, not hinder them?
Minister.
I think one of the key things that Mr Briggs and I have is a close relationship in terms of housing matters. We meet on a regular basis, and I think when the housing bill was brought out, we discussed that at the start, and I engaged with them and said we would continue to do that in that regard. As I said, the rent controls, we will listen to stakeholders and continue to listen to stakeholders to get the balance, to make sure we're getting investment into the sector, but also making sure we're protecting the most vulnerable. But happy to meet with them any time to discuss the bill.
Supplementary, Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister outline how they now plan to proceed with the bill and ensure its critical measures around tackling homelessness are achieved?
Minister.
Subject to parliamentary passage of the bill, the homelessness duties will help to prevent homelessness before it occurs and help ensure households do not face the trauma and disruption of homelessness. We will work with stakeholders, including in areas such as health and justice, to ensure we get the guidance and training right to support the duties and help identify the best timing for implementation.
Supplementary, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In light of the historic decision by Weedvale Housing Association shareholders to reject takeover by Places for People in recent months, will the Minister consider making provision in the Housing Bill for enhanced protections for community-based registered social landlords to ensure they aren't unnecessarily taken over, perhaps by raising the threshold for tenant ballots to the same as that in the Cooperative and Community Benefit Societies Act, a two-thirds threshold?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I know Mr Sweeney has raised this in the Chamber a number of times, and we've had a couple of discussions around about that. You will know that Housing Regulators is also involved in the process, but I'm happy to meet with them again, still if in post, to discuss that matter. And as I said, it will be the continuing process of engaging with members throughout the bill process, but happy to meet with them to discuss that.
A supplementary, Patrick Harvey.
I'm pleased that the Minister still supports the principle of rent controls, but he'll be aware that there are those lobbying for the vested interests of landlords, not tenants, who are seeking to water down those proposals, for example, in relation to between-tenancy rent increases and automatic rent condition assessments. Can he give us his assurance that he will oppose such measures, which, if taken forward, would make these measures as useless as the old rent pressure zones, which have never been in effect anywhere in Scotland?
And before I ask the Minister to reply, could I please ask all members to show some courtesy and respect to the member that has the floor, which wasn't any of the members who were seeking to make sedentary comments. Minister.
Yeah, thank you for that, Presiding Officer. I think the key thing, as I mentioned in previous answers, we'll be continuing to engage with stakeholders in that regard and other members. Mr Harvey and I, when he was in post, obviously met the stakeholders at a particular time, and happy to engage with them as we go through the bill process to discuss the points that he's raised.
Question number three, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government regarding any potential impact on devolved benefits in Scotland, what representation it plans to make to the UK Government regarding its proposed changes to welfare benefits for people with mental health issues?
Minister Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Last week, the Cabinet Secretary saw urgent clarity from the DWP that people receiving adult disability payment will continue to receive the reserve benefits they rely on. She has also sought assurances that the UK Government will not seek to impose cuts to expenditure on the Scottish Government. This Government will never accept the cruel welfare reforms being pursued by the DWP, which further stigmatise and impoverish disabled people. In contrast, in 24-25, we are committing a record £6.3 billion for benefits expenditure, £1.1 billion more than we receive from the UK Government for Social Security. Scotland's Social Security system is designed on the principles of dignity, fairness and respect. Those are the values of this Government and of the people of Scotland.
Rona Mackay.
I welcome that response from the Minister. Does the Minister agree with me that the UK Government should look to the Scottish Government model of Social Security Scotland and start treating people with dignity, fairness and respect? And they can start that by scrapping the proposed welfare cuts for people with mental health issues?
Minister.
Yeah, I would agree on that. The UK Government's heartless approach to Social Security appears to be entirely focused on reducing the support to those who need it. Now, disabled people's organisations in Scotland have already warned that the UK Government's planned changes, and I quote, cruel, punitive and ineffective in terms of getting disabled people back into work. Meanwhile, our compassionate and caring approach, which is fundamentally different to that of the DWP, has been backed by experts. The Scottish Government completely rejects these proposals, and I call on the UK Government to halt these plans so they can be properly scrutinised.
Supplementary, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Minister, you will recognise that the waiting times now for benefits in Scotland are longer than they are for DWP. Will he take action so that people who are waiting to hear whether they are entitled to a claim or not are not left with the stress of waiting for months before they get any response from Social Security Scotland?
Minister.
Yeah, I thank the member for his question. I know he's had an interest in the area and he's raised it with the Cabinet Secretary on a number of occasions. I will engage with the Cabinet Secretary in that regard and feed these back to yourself, Mr Balfour.
Question number four, Sandesh Gohani.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its plans to introduce long-term rent controls.
Minister Paul McLennan.
Probably just referring back to a couple of answers I've mentioned already. We'll continue to engage, obviously, with stakeholders on an ongoing basis. Obviously, the committee process will be set out by Parliament and go on. And I think I've mentioned right at the very start of the process in terms of meeting with Mr Briggs and Mr Griffin and also with Mr Rennie, I was in terms of that, happy to meet with the member to discuss any issues in terms of that. But the Parliament will set its own parliamentary process in terms of that, including the committee stage.
Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you. Declaration of interest with a property in Glasgow. Rents for two-bedroom properties in Greater Glasgow have increased by an average of 22.3% from the year before, largely due to the SNP green rent cap. Does the Minister recognise this impact, unlike Patrick Harvey, or is the SNP still beholden to green dogma?
Minister.
As I said, I'll continue to engage with stakeholders on an ongoing basis in that regard and take all the evidence that we mentioned about that would come for that. I think the committee stage will be incredibly important in terms of that when we go out to the calls for evidence. Obviously, we'll be speaking to local government, housing, planning committee and also the homelessness also around about social justice, but happy to engage with the member on that. But as I said, the committee stage will have that call for evidence and of course, I think we would get some, I would imagine, evidence on that particular point that he mentions, but happy to meet with them to discuss that further.
Supplementary, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A fairer, well-regulated private rented sector is in the interests of both tenants and responsible landlords. Can the Minister say what lessons have the Scottish Government drawn from our European neighbours where rent controls have been implemented successfully?
Minister.
We have considered a wide range of information on evidence on rent controls, including bespoke research briefing from the UK Collaborative Centre for Housing. Evidence which included assessment and references to earlier academic work on rent controls systems in both Berlin and in Ireland. We've also met with members of Ireland's Residential Tenancies Board. We continue to consider these experiences of other countries' rent control systems to work closely with a range of stakeholders to understand their perspectives as we deliver a rent control system that is right for Scotland.
And supplementary, Katie Clark.
Could the Minister provide a timetable as to when a rent control system will be in operation, given that the system recently introduced by the now departed Tenants' Rights Minister introduced a complicated system of transitional measures? Does the Minister envisage that these measures will be in operation until there are rent controls?
Minister.
As I mentioned, I think, previously in the Chamber, I will be taking the bill forward again if I'm in the same post after today. I think one of the key things, again, is when the new First Minister is in place and have a chance to discuss that, that obviously be something that will be reviewed as the Housing Bill and the process around about that. Again, part of the process will be determined by the Parliament itself in that regard. So happy to come back to the member on that particular point.
Question number five, Keith Brown.
To ask the Scottish Government what support it is providing to organisations in Clackmannanshire to tackle poverty and inequalities.
Minister Paul McLennan.
The Scottish Government is supporting a range of work in Clackmannanshire to tackle poverty and inequality. And I think probably around about 6 months ago, I visited the CAB in Clackmannanshire, I think in Alloa, to discuss the issues that they had in that particular area. This includes obviously collaboration with the local authority, Family Wellbeing Partnership, which is supporting improved local services and outcomes. The Early Adopter Community Project, which funds local authority to build a system of childcare by developing services and supporting children and their families with childcare costs. And of course, a range of third sector and grassroots organisations through different funds intended to tackle poverty and inequality and improve outcomes for children, families, adult learners and communities.
Can I thank the Minister for his answer? I'm aware that there will be a ministerial visit to Clackmannanshire shortly to learn more about some of the innovative work that's taking place currently between the local authority, the third sector and communities within the Family Wellbeing Partnership, which is delivering significant positive outcomes. But what more can the Scottish Government do to support early intervention and prevention initiatives like this, which help those experiencing the greatest disadvantage?
Minister.
Yeah, as you said, the Scottish Government is a key partner alongside the local authority in the Clackmannanshire Family Wellbeing Partnership. Officials meet regularly with colleagues from the local authority to progress and support the partnership's aims to tackle poverty and inequality and improve services. The partnership is in turn supporting wide-range engagement with local partners and stakeholders. Additionally, senior Scottish Government officials, including the Permanent Secretary, visited in March to learn about the work in Clackmannanshire with the DFM and Minister for Children and Young People, and Keeping the Promise, visited in August and October 23, respectively.
Question number six, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Before I ask the question, I'd like to remind members of my register of interest that I rent out long-term family homes in Moray. To ask the Scottish Government what analysis it has carried out on prospective rent rises following the expiry of the rent cap.
Minister Paul McLennan.
Following expiry of the rent cap, we continue to closely monitor all available evidence on the private rented sector. The regulations that came into force on 1st of April to temporarily modify how rent in relation to most tenancies are determined upon referral to Rent Service Scotland or the First Tier Tribunal. In order to smooth the transition out of the rent cap and protect tenants from steep rent increases which could have been experienced if there was a sudden move back to open market rent levels, this will provide important data to consider on rent increases going forward.
Edward Mountain.
Interesting. I think the missing point was, since the removal of the rent cap, on average rents have increased by 14%. What has also happened is landlords have held back on improving the fabric of their properties while the rent cap was in place. So the rent cap has seen bigger than average increases and climate targets threatened. Is this government as proud as the Greens are in achieving these negatives?
Minister.
I think there are a number of points. One, as I said, is learning from the process as we come out of there. I think, two, there is different examples of rent increases in different parts of Scotland, and I think that's part of the evidence we need to consider and look at carefully in regarding that as we continue to look at the bill going forward.
Supplementary, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister outline how the new regulations that have come into force build on the existing protections that were in place for tenants prior to the emergency rent cap measures, and how these continue to ensure the Scottish Government provides much greater protection for tenants than anywhere else in the UK?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Even before the emergency measures, tenants in Scotland were able to refer rent increases to a rent officer who had the power to vary the rent proposed by the landlord. The temporal modifications to rent adjudication meant that a rent officer will not set the rent higher than what a landlord had originally proposed and may be set rent at a lower value in line with the tapered approach that is in place to support transition away from the emergency measures. In England and Wales, the respective residential property tribunals will not set a disputed rent below the market value, and tenants may be required to pay tribunal fees.
Question number 7, Sharon Derry.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to tackle homelessness in Ayrshire.
Minister Paul McLennan.
Local authorities have a legal duty to help people who are homeless or at risk of being homeless. The three Ayrshire local authorities will receive almost £970 million in 2024-25 through local government settlement. This is used to fund a range of services, including homelessness services. On top of this, the Scottish Government is providing £30.326 million in 2024-25 to Ayrshire authorities who deliver more affordable homes and £611,000 to support them with transition to rapid rehousing. The aim of the rapid rehousing is to ensure people who have a settled home as quickly as possible.
Sharon Derry.
Thank you. There is widespread concern of the Scottish Government's £200 million cut to housing. I recently visited Barnardo Scotland's South Ayrshire services. During the visit, Shine, their women's mentoring service, highlighted concerns around housing provisions for women, meaning they may leave prison and custody without knowing where they are to sleep that night. This can lead to barriers accessing further support, as many social security applications require a home address. Can the Minister outline what action the Scottish Government is taking to tackle this ongoing issue, and would he be willing to meet with me and this group to discuss this further?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think there are a number of issues I think I mentioned about the homelessness prevention duties that will come on to local authorities in terms of that, and I think that will make a real difference when it comes to it, but I'm already discussing that with local authorities. At the moment, you'll be aware that there was an additional £80 million over 2 years announced for the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, which will support continuation of the previous National Acquisition Programme, which delivered more than 1,000 affordable homes. At the end of this month, I'm meeting all local authorities to discuss that acquisition plan, and of course I'd be happy to meet with Sharon Derry and colleagues to discuss the issues that she raised.
Question number 8, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Housing Minister has had with ministerial colleagues regarding the potential impact of the new build heat standard on the completion of new homes.
Minister Paul McLennan.
Yeah, I regularly meet with ministerial colleagues to discuss varying and associated portfolio interests, including the heat and buildings policy. This standard was scrutinised by Local Government Housing and Planning Committee and approved without opposition. It's an essential part of our commitment to reach net zero and will have a positive impact on new housing. This was subject to full consultation in 2021 and in 2022, with both consultations showing strong support. And obviously, we've heard the concerns raised about the new built heat standard in rural and island communities and are taking these on board fully.
Liam Kerr.
From the 1st of April, the new build heat standard bans direct emission heating systems, including bioenergy sources such as wood-burning stoves. Now, the Scottish Government's bioenergy policy statement consultation says, as a renewable and potentially net zero energy source, bioenergy may represent the best option to help decarbonise some homes. So will the Minister listen to his government colleagues and review the ban on wood-burning stoves in Scotland's homes, or are this government's strings still being pulled by his former Green Party colleagues?
Minister.
As I mentioned, obviously we've heard the concerns about the reliance on wood burning stoves, and rural areas and are taking those fully on board. Just last week I visited Egg and discussed a number of issues up there. This issue was raised, and I said I would come back to them on that particular point. The Scottish Government does recognise the emergency use of heating will sometimes be required in terms of that, which does, of course, including wood-burning stoves. But as I said, you know, we'll continue to engage fully with the stakeholders and others in terms of that regard. And again, happy to take that and have an engagement with Mr Kerr on that particular point.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on social justice. There will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change position should they so wish. Thank you.